cooperation all season. Appreciate your support and passion for the Texans and for this team. Just a quick statement here, and then we'll open it up to some questions. John, you'll have the first question when finished up here. But I would say, you know, these decisions are always difficult, okay? Anytime you're put in a position of leadership, sometimes you have to make decisions that are difficult. It's never personal. But ultimately, that was the, you know, position that I've been placed in by the McNair family to do the right thing, you know, for the organization. I would say when you just rewind here and go back to a year ago, kind of where we were, I don't remember if we were in this room, but I think it was another room when, you know, when I started, when I took over, I'd say, you know, the organization was in a pretty rough spot. And I think for where we were then to where we are now, we're in a lot better position. And quite frankly, I think that's because of the leadership and the guidance and the direction that David Culley provided this football team. I have a lot of personal respect and appreciation and admiration for what David did for this team, for a lot of people in this building. Forever will be indebted to him for what he did for us. And I would say our relationship, quite frankly, he's the same person however many years ago when I first met him at the scouting combine that he was yesterday, when I met with him face-to-face, one-on-one, and informed him of the decision to move forward and to go in a different direction. These decisions are never easy. I know this year was, you know, I would say a challenging year, but it was a productive year. I'd say when we met, I want to say back in September, you know, we talked about, you know, where the team was and kind of some of the goals for the season. Some of it, you know, was about the process and some of the things that we were trying to put in place. And I'd say this business is twofold, right? It's results and it's process. So process leads to results. So how can we establish and implement some processes from the beginning? And I think when you look around at the building and the foundation that's been put in place, you know, David had a lot to do with that, or has had a lot to do with that. So, again, it was a difficult decision. It's probably one of the hardest decisions I've had to make in my life on a personal level. But that's the position that I was put in. And ultimately, the McNairs have bestowed upon me the authority to do what I feel is best for the Houston Texans organization. It's not about one person. My responsibility and commitment is to everybody within this organization, from players, staff, to coaches, to front office, to biz ops. Like, that's my responsibility. And I'm going to do everything in my power to try to continue to move this franchise forward to the best of my ability. So, again, I think this more than anything is about being grateful and thankful for what David did for this organization, what he provided for us, what he provided for us personally, what he provided for me personally. In the end, this is my decision. This was something that I felt that we needed to do that was in the best interest of the organization. So that's why I would sit here today. So, you know, having said that, you know, I'll answer some questions. John, go ahead and start with you.
Everybody assumes you're going to hire somebody you know from the Patriots.
What are you looking for in your next head coach that you haven't yet this year? Yeah, I would say I don't think anybody should assume anything. I think we're going to be, you know, very deliberate. I'll be very deliberate with this process. The most important thing is just finding, I would say, the best fit for this organization. Again, there's probably 1,000 things that go into that, John. So for me to kind of articulate one or two, I don't think is fair. But again, there's a myriad of things that this role, and again, it's all about the job description of what do you want from that person, what do you want from that individual. I mean, there's so many things that go into it. So I would say I wouldn't assume anything. I think we're going to go be very thorough and just try to make the best decision for this organization, whatever that entails. Go ahead, Mark.
You said in the statement that among the reasons you made your decision with David, you said philosophical difference from long term. Can you share with us generally speaking what you're talking about?
Yeah, it's a fair question, Mark. I think out of respect to everybody involved, I don't think talking about the nature of those conversations. What I would say is if you just take a global view, let's take the Houston Texans out of it, okay? If you look at any big corporation, any big business, Google, Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, look at it from a global perspective. At the end of each year, what you want to do is make an evaluation and assessment about where your program is, what are some of the things that you did well, what are some of the areas maybe that you didn't do as well, that you struggled, and what do we need to do to fix those problems moving forward? So I would say when you look at our team, there was some things that we did okay, and there's some other areas, quite frankly, that weren't good enough. I would say All of us need to be better. We need to be better. I certainly need to be better. There might be some things that I can do to help whomever that coach is, and you know, maybe I could have done a better job to help David with some of those things. Ultimately, I'm going to take accountability and responsibility. You know, I'm not going to hide from those things. But to your question, I think, you know, it's about moving forward, and it's about, I would say, you know, being, I would say, open-minded to potentially making some changes, whatever those entail, okay, whatever that constitution looks like. So, again, it's not about one thing. Again, I think out of fairness to everybody, I don't think it's, you know, the right thing to talk about what those differences are or were. I think the overarching theme is we need to be better, we need to get better, and we need to find ways to get better. I'd say when you look around this league, it's the teams that can ID problems, assess, fix, ID them, and implement them. Those are the teams that have success. And I would say, again, to take a big picture global view, when you look at organizational philosophy, organizational behavior, whatever the business entails, the businesses and entities that do those types of things are the some of the better businesses, and they give themselves a chance. And I think you have to be willing to make changes sometimes when changes are difficult or whatever that entails. But there's a lot of layers that go into that, and that's kind of what the off-season discussion is as you evaluate your team, as you evaluate your personnel, as you evaluate your scheme. So
there are some conflicting reports about how many years, guaranteed years, were left in Coley's contract. Could you clear how many there were left?
Yeah, I'm not going to get into any, and this is consistent with what I've said from the beginning. We're not going to talk about anybody's individual status, their contractual situation, what that entails. I don't think that's fair to anybody involved.
You hired him at first. You said one of probably his strongest qualities is his ability to work with people and to motivate people. You spent 4 days here evaluating that. What from the past year did you learn about him that led to your ultimate decision?
Yeah, it's a good question, Brooks. I would say those were consistent. I think the one thing, and you all met with him multiple times during the course of the week, very consistent day to day. And I think the players, and I think when you look at the way we played, and the effort, and I would say the toughness, and you know, the consistency and the competitive spirit that I would say that we played with, forget about the execution, the X and O's for a minute, I'd say a lot of that, you know, should be attributed to David and his attitude and his mindset. So that hasn't changed from the day he walked in the door to the minute, you know, I met with him yesterday directly. So again, to Mark's question, I think philosophically there were some things in the end that, you know, maybe we saw a little bit differently. So that was really the impetus for the decision that was made yesterday. Go ahead, Aaron.
When you hired David, did you think he was going to be a long-term solution as the head coach?
Yeah, we hired David because we thought he was the best fit for the Houston Texans organization at the time, and I still feel that way. So again, this is a year-to-year endeavor. And what we do, so each year is its own entity. You kind of have to look at it in its own bucket. And we made a commitment to David because we thought and we felt that he was the best coach for our organization at that time, and we still feel that way. So, again, my responsibility organizationally in the position I'm in is to assess everything in detail from top to bottom, from coaching to players to our operation, whatever it is that we do. So, again, that's not going to change. It's not going to change today. It's not going to change next year. So whether it's 1 year, 2 years, 4 years, 5 years, whatever it is, my responsibility is to, at the end of the season, at the end of the year, evaluate everything and make the decision I feel is best for, you know, McNair family, Houston Texans organization, and we're going to continue to do that. That's not going to change. Go ahead, Aaron. Yeah, I mean, honestly, I'd say a lot of the qualities that David possessed, like, those aren't going to necessarily change. But I think, you know, coaching, a head coach position is really, it's probably a leadership position more than anything else. I think a lot of times people get caught up in, you know, the X's and O's. Now, there's X and O strategy component to that. But again, it's within the context and the construct of everything else that's around that individual. So our responsibility, my responsibility, is to continue to provide support and create an infrastructure so that our entire organization, our entire operation can succeed. So I would say, honestly, a lot of the qualities that David possessed, like those more than likely will not change.
Is it fair to say that those philosophical differences are based on X's and O's, though, or based on all the other qualities that you say you had? Speak to that at all as far as...
Yeah, I respect the question just out of fairness. I think there's a lot of things that go into it. And I think just generally speaking, okay, like when you evaluate a team or go through an operation or an organization, you know, we always have to be, I would say, sort of open-minded to change, at least entertaining change, not necessarily change just to change, but there has to be an impetus to change. And I'd say just if we move it over to a football perspective, you know, I mean, look, the results are what the results are. There were certain areas that, you know, quite frankly, it wouldn't perform very well over the course of multiple weeks. It wasn't as if it was, I would say, 1 week or one game. And, again, going back to what I mentioned earlier, it's about fixing problems and finding solutions, and we need to do a better job of that. I need to do a better job of that. So, again, it's not necessarily one specific thing. I think in the end there was some differences about, I would say, next steps or how we move forward, not necessarily rearview mirror about what has happened. Go ahead, Jerome. Just to go ahead and follow up. Yep.
Could you fire Tim Kelly was also let go. So what would you like to see from the offense? Obviously, y'all underperformed in that area.
Yeah. I mean, I know mentioned, you know, in the release about Timmy making some changes offensively. You know, I think, again, it's about production, you know, and, I mean, offensively, you know, we did some good things. When you look at some of the things that, you know, Davis was able to do, and, you know, I would say the production of the quarterback is, you know, the reflection of the coaches that put him in a position to be successful. So, again, I think just there's some areas just quite frankly that we need to improve and we need to get better. You know, I have a lot of respect for Tim. I think Tim's a really good coach. You know, I think in the end we just felt that that was, you know, one of the things that we needed to do, that we should do. And, again, in terms of our next step moving forward in this organization. Go ahead.
The level of local NFL fans is at the lowest it's been since Bum Phillips was fired by the Oilers back after the 1980 season. How do you get that back?
Yeah, no, we have a lot of work to do. Again, I think, you know, this year I think we put a really good foundation in place. I'd say when the infrastructure and the team and the players, I mean, you all talk to the players on a week-to-week basis in terms of the attitude, the professionalism. You know, we got a lot of good production and performance from a lot of players this season, some, I mean, career, I would say, level of performance. When you move forward, again, rearview mirror, here's what's happened moving forward. You know, our situation right now is a lot better than it was, I would say, when we sat here last year, from a asset allocation, from a salary cap structure, from resources or players in the building, to externally opportunities that might be available for us in free agency, to, you know, right now we have the third overall pick or whatever that is. You know, whether or not we stay at three, that's a whole separate discussion, but we'll talk about the draft a little bit later. So I think there's some pretty good things that are in place. Again, there's a lot of work to do, you know, in front of us, and we're not afraid to roll up our sleeves. But again, I think the competitive spirit and the mindset and the thought process of the people that are here in the building is overall positive. You all aren't here on a day-to-day basis, so you can't really, I can't really, it's hard for me to articulate what that entails and what that looks like, but I think there's some things going on underneath the surface that we've made some advances. And again, ultimately, those things have to transfer over into production on the field. Nobody realizes that more than I do. And we're committed to making whatever changes are necessary and to trying to put together the best team possible for the 2022 season, whatever the construct looks like. Brian, go ahead. Go ahead, Brian.
You just said earlier that when you hired Culley, you believed it'd be a long-term hire. Did you get your first hire right? Did you get your first head coach decision? Did you get that right or wrong?
Yeah, it's not for me to judge. I would say, you know, we hired David because we believed in him. I believed in him. And I would say when you look at some of the things that we're able to put in place in the building and where the program is right now, I'd say he deserves a lot of credit for that. So, again, I think it's important to take a global view in each year. Unfortunately, this is a year-to-year bottom-line business, so you never – you kind of – this is like when people have a one-year, three-year, five-year plan, or even when somebody takes over a new job, 60-day, 90-day, 200-day plan, whatever that is. I think sometimes it's hard to kind of, you know, talk about that because some of it is very subjective and sort of, you know, not real. I think what you have to do is just deal in the real, deal in now, deal with the day-to-day, and day-to-day, week-to-week, month-to-month, and that's how you build something sustainable over a long period of time. So I think in your mind you have a vision of, okay, X number of years, and this is what it's going to look like. And, again, it might come to fruition that way, but along the way you might run into some bumps, and you have to make decisions ultimately that you feel are best for your organization at that time. Go ahead, Brian. Go ahead.
and obviously you know New England, and that it's a different situation with Belichick, but if you look at New England, Kansas City, Green Bay, some of the top organizations, Pittsburgh, they haven't made a change like this. It's led within the current regime to a Super Bowl. What's going to make this situation different?
Yeah, I think those organizations that you mentioned, I mean, that's who we're chasing. Those are some of the better organizations in sports, and we're trying to put ourselves, I would say, on a similar level. Are we there yet? Not even close. Do we have a lot of work to get to that point? Absolutely. I think there has to be an expectation and consistent standard of performance from everybody on a day-to-day basis, not just football. It has to be scouting. It has to be personnel. It has to be data technology. It has to be data science. It has to be sports performance. It has to be nutrition. So when you do those things along the way, that's what's ultimately going to give you the best chance for sustainable success. And I would just say, not to speak specifically on the one situation, but I probably know that one the best. Those were some of the things that we were able to do over the course of a long period of time. Obviously, there's some key people and key components that are a part of that, and we're going to probably have to be able to do that at some point as well. So, you know, candidly, that's one of the reasons that I was brought here to try to do that. And, you know, I'm grateful for the opportunity and the belief that the McNair family has instilled, you know, that feel that way about me. Now, I have to, in turn, be accountable to them and be able to perform and be able to deliver something that they're proud of and the city of Houston is proud of. And it's going to take a lot of work, but the one thing I've never been afraid to work. And I think if we're going to fearlessly evolve as an organization, we can't be afraid. We're going to have some bumps and roads along the way. There's going to be some things that don't work out the way that really we hope, but ultimately we just have to keep pressing forward and take as many people along with us and create an environment that's conducive to winning on a day-to-day basis, which that will ultimately lead to more sustainable success over a long period of time, which those programs that you mentioned, that's what they've been able to do. I mean, I would say nobody has, and we competed against them, I would say, almost yearly, but, I mean, nobody respects what the Pittsburgh Steelers have done more than myself. And when you look at Coach Tomlin, I mean, you look at the organization, right, basically three coaches over the course of the Rooney ownership, right? They went from Chuck to Bill to Mike. And when Mike was hired, Mike was a coordinator for 1 year in Minnesota, right? He was 30-something years old, maybe 31 years old, whatever it was. And at the time, I don't think people knew, like, okay, Mike Tomlin is going to be not have a losing season in 15 years. I think the Rooneys saw Mike Tomlin and said, you know what, that's our guy. We believe in him, and we're going to give him the runway and the opportunity. And, I mean, look, Mike's as good of a coach, I would say as good of a leader as there is, and forget about sports, probably in, like, organizational behavior. So I have a lot of respect and admiration. And Brian, I think it's a good point. Look, that's the goal. Boy, that's a really – that's a difficult goal and a difficult mountaintop to reach, but that's what we have to strive for. And we're not there. Like, I'm not going to sit here and tell you that we're there. We've certainly made some incremental progress, I would say, this year, and hopefully we can continue to make more incremental progress, understanding that change is going to be a part of it.
David, on Saturday.
Go ahead, Sarah, go ahead. Yeah, I think they've been very open-minded. They've listened. They've been very receptive. And ultimately, my goal is to do right by their family and this organization. And, you know, you have to have honest conversations. Sometimes they're hard conversations. And they believe in me. So I, in turn, have to take ownership and, you know, give them the information and do what I feel makes the most sense. And really, if we just take myself out of it for a second, what we're trying to build in terms of our systems, in terms of our processes, are things that are sustainable for a long period of time, so that when I'm not here, which at some point I probably won't be here, like the Houston Texans organization can continue to move forward. So we're sort of at the infantile stages of kind of building and growing, and this is a youthful organization. The organization is 20 years old, so it's a young organization. It's a new organization. And we're trying to do things that their family can carry with them for a long period of time. And honestly, they might supersede the time that I'm here. So while I'm here, I'm committed to them. I'm committed to this organization. I'm committed to the people in the building. But they listen. They're receptive. And ultimately, they're placing trust in my vision and plan for what we are going to do moving forward. And that's a lot of responsibility to put on my shoulders. But that's okay. Like, that's why I'm here, and I'm not afraid to do it.
Go ahead, Sarah.
You have a follow-up?
Yeah, just as part of that plan, have you had discussions with Cal
Fowler, what is your plan with Deshaun Watson?
Yeah, I think there's going to be a number of things that we talk about during the offseason. I think that particular situation, I don't think there's any is more clarity today than there was here previously, but we're going to work through it, and ultimately we're going to do, what we feel is best for the organization. Go ahead.
When Coach Cully got here, there was uncertainty with the Deshaun Watson situation, and there was high turnover with the roster. The new coach that's coming in is going to be dealing with the same situation. How long would that coach have to fix this situation, or are they on a year-by-year evaluation?
Yeah, I would say all of us are kind of year to year, day by day. So I think the point that you're making is a good point. So we have 31, 32 players that'll be free agents. So there's going to be a lot of new players on the team next year. I would say there's some players that aren't under contract for next year that played here last season that, we're going to have conversations with the hope of trying to bring them back into our program and kind of help us moving forward. So I think the one thing that is consistent in the NFL, which those of us that have been in it for a long time, change is constant. That's the one thing that's constant. There's going to be change. I would say, to Brian's point, there's probably some organizations and constructs maybe have a little bit less change. But when you look at the overarching theme and the overarching identity of the NFL and what happens, there's a lot of change. So we'll take it one day at a time, and we'll just try to do what we feel is best on a day-to-day basis and just try to make consistent, good decisions, repetitive action over the course of a long period of time, and ultimately see where that ends up. Go ahead, Randy. Go ahead, Randy.
John. When you do make your hire of a head coach, how much control will they have over the staff that they want to bring in, as opposed to maybe you guys dictating what might happen?
Yeah, no, we're not going to dictate anything. I think we're going to have open discussions and dialogue, and I think you're always open-minded and receptive, whoever the coach is, about what their thoughts are and plans are from a staffing standpoint. I think we have a lot of good coaches on our staff here currently. Are there going to be some changes on our coaching staff even moving forward, beyond the head coach? I'd say there's a possibility. But, again, I would say it's probably really too early to make any declaration on that point. But, whomever that coach is, certainly receptive to their feedback and, their plans and their comfort level with coaches that they're going to work with on a day-to-day basis. Go ahead, John.
Did you see enough of Bills to believe
he can be the starter going into training camp, and considering all the moves you made to get players to Lovey's system, is it safe to say Lovey will be back? Yeah, those are good questions. I think to the second question first, I have a lot of respect and appreciation for what Lovey did this season. There's things defensively that we can certainly do better, but with the ability to take the ball away, we played better in the red area, as the year went on. So, again, I think we're going to have to kind of take that one day at a time and kind of see where we end up on a coaching front. But I think Lovey is a good coach. I think he's done a lot for our program, and I think he's done a lot for, our system, and our players have a lot of belief in him. To your first question on Mills, I think Davis made a lot of progress this season. He's under contract. He's one of the few quarterbacks we have under contract. Tyrod's a free agent. The Deshaun situation, to Sarah's point, is something that we're going to have to deal with. But I'd say, he made a lot of progress and strides. Those first however many games that he played, he was thrust into, any rookie quarterback was, would be put in a tough spot. But when you look at the body of work and some of the things that he was able to accomplish, he made a lot of progress. And, I'd say, when you look at him relative to some of the other rookie quarterbacks that played last season, you can make an argument that he was as good or better as, any one of them. So what does that mean for next year? That doesn't really mean anything. We felt Davis was a good player when we drafted him, and I think some of the things that you saw from him this season were certainly confirmation of that. He's got a long way to go as well. He'd be the first to tell you that. He's got to learn about, I would say, more than anything, defenses and what the other team is trying to do when you take it out of, what are we running? I think for any quarterback, the ability to understand what's going on that side of the ball helps you as much as anything about, here's the play call and here's what this guy's doing on this play.
Go ahead. Added pressure to get this next coaching hire right, given the fact that most general managers do not get an opportunity to go for a third.
Only the pressure that you guys put on me. So I don't, I'm immune to pressure. The pressure, we live with pressure every day. Everybody deals with, I'd say, a lot of difficult situations that we're dealing with. I'm blessed to be in the position that I'm in. I'm excited for the opportunity here moving forward, try to continue to build our program out with whomever the next coach is. So I'm excited about the opportunity. Again, you know, pressure is however you define it. And so, again, the pressure will probably come more externally from you all, but, I mean, that's okay. That's part of the fun of it. So, I wouldn't say there's a timeline, Mark. I think we'll be, you know, be patient, and however long it takes, it takes. And then, you know, when we have a solution that we feel comfortable about, then we'll go ahead. Go ahead. Well, one last one. Yep.
Down here today, you said you feel like this team's in a better position now than they were in training camp in September. What areas do you point to feel that way?
Yeah, I would say just the overall, I would say the building, the attitude, you know, the belief and some of the things that we're doing. I would say, when you look at the way the players responded throughout the course of the year, the way they went out there, and I would say performed on a week-to-week basis. Again, take the execution out of it, but, you know, they went out there and they performed. They played their ass off. They played with a lot of competitive spirit, and we put ourselves in a position, quite frankly, to maybe win some more games that we could have won or at least had the opportunity to do so. So, again, I think just the attitude, the approach, the day-to-day when you're around the people in the building on a day-to-day basis. Again, I think that goes back to the environment and the attitude that David was able to put in place. So I think we have some players that are committed to us. They're excited to be here for next year. We made some commitments to them, you know, during the season. They wanted to be a part of that. They made a purposeful decision to be a part of what they're doing because they believe in some of the things that we're doing. That doesn't necessarily mean anything other than they want to be here and they believe in what we're doing, and they understand there's a lot of work, but we're about the work, and the NFL is about the work. And I'd say if the one thing, you know, how you want to define the Houston Texans for 2022, it's going to be about the work. All right. Thanks. Go ahead. Go ahead. One more. Yep.
Yeah. Can you talk about how much autonomy the next coach will have? Like, I know that you are in the booth during the game, so there's a lot of conversation about in-game decisions. Will the next coach, will you be in the booth with the next coach? Will he have the ability to make the final decision about everything that happens on game day? What will you say to that?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think those discussions will be very organic, and I would say my philosophy has always been to serve and do the right thing by the people involved, so whatever that entails, if it entails doing something else, if it entails doing something less because that's the best thing for the organization, then I'm more than willing to do that. I think that's been my philosophy and attitude and track record over the course of my career. You know, if you were to talk to anybody in New England, hopefully they would tell you the same thing. So I think for better or for worse, I mean, the reality is probably my perspective is a little bit unique, maybe relative to some other people in my position. It doesn't necessarily mean it's better, it's right, or it's wrong, but I would say my training, I was trained to kind of look at things from a global perspective. So if I can be an asset and provide some information or input wherever that may be necessary, then, you know, that's what I'm here to do. Again, my goal is to serve the Houston Texans, to serve the head coach, to serve the people in this building. And I can't undo, you know, the fact that, you know, I was in a press box for 18 of my 20 years in New England, you know, in a various and sundry roles, and I'm proud of that. And, you know, my job, I just want to help, I want to serve, and I want to provide a sounding board for the head coach, our staff, whomever else in the building, because that's my obligation and responsibility. Go ahead, one more.
When making the decision to move on from the head coach, how much...
This will make this the last one, Omar. Yeah. Okay.
How much are you having to consider who else becomes available in the coaching market versus, like, who wasn't available last year and who might not be available next year, who is available next
year? Yeah, those are independent entities. I don't think you make said decision based on, well, all of a sudden something has changed or something is different. I think you just have to first start with your situation, evaluate it, make an honest assessment, make the decision, and then if that so happens to be in conjunction with other things that happen during the league, that's kind of out of our control. It's out of my control. So I would say, to answer your question, that's really not the criteria with which and the lens through which you look and make those decisions.
But how much did it factor in this time? Was it a factor at all for you in taking the several?
No, I would say you have to look at everything as an independent entity. I think we're taking the information here about the Houston Texans, where we are, rearview mirror, here are the things that would happen. Moving forward, what's ahead, what's the best thing for us, and that's what we did. All right. Thanks, y'all. Appreciate it.